anointing is empowering. The kingdom of the Lord is within me.
Welcome to the prophetic teaching and healing ministry of Pastor Olufemi Fadeyi, the senior pastor of Divine Glory Christian Church. We bring you this faith and power-filled, life-transforming word of God. For the scripture says, the entrance of his word gives light and understanding to the simple. Get ready for the miraculous and be blessed.
Somebody shout hallelujah. God bless us all. We may take our seats in the Holy Ghost. Amen. Praise God. Glory be to God. Oh, my God. Something is happening here. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Amen. The Lord is taking us into a higher height in our Christian walk today. And I'm glad to tell somebody, when next they see you, they see Jesus. When next they see you, they see the glory of God. When next men see you, they see the power of God. Come on, tell somebody, I'm going higher. In my walk with God, I'm going higher. I mean, I'm stepping up in my Christianity. Glory be to God. Father, we thank you once again. Because we know today we are having a fresh encounter of a lifetime. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Amen. By the grace of God, we start a new series today. And this is a wonderful series because I see somebody rediscovering Christianity in this series. You are going to rediscover Christianity in this series. All the details of your life shall be touched. By the mercies of God, you will never remain the same coming out of this series. You're going to step out of this series into higher realms of glory. Come and lift up your two hands and say, I am stepping into higher realms of glory. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. It is titled, The Ultimate of the Christian Race. The ultimate of the Christian race. The ultimate of the Christian race, part number one. Every man has been called into a race. And the one who called you into the race has called you with some specific instructions to follow. And he has a particular end in mind that you are to achieve. Am I talking to somebody here? So, ladies and gentlemen, the ultimate of the Christian race defines your final destination in Christianity as proposed by God. Now, listen, ladies and gentlemen. Hebrews chapter number 12, verse number 1 says, we also being surrounded by this so great cloud of witnesses. He said, let us therefore run the race that is set before us. Let us therefore run the race that is set before us, setting aside every sin and weight that easily beset us. Let us therefore run the race that is set before us, looking up to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. The scripture says, before every man is a race. Before you, the Bible says there is a race. And it said, you have been called into this race and every of these witness, they are all watching you. They are hailing you. They are looking at how you're going to run your race and you're going to come out gloriously in the race. Many people have started running the race. Some finished halfway. I mean, some didn't get to the finishing line. Some one way or the other, they didn't get to finish what God has proposed for their lives. But I'm glad to tell somebody here, premature death is costing your life. Amen. You will surely get to the finishing line. Amen.
by the mercies of God, you will surely get to the finishing point. Everything God has in mind for you, I say you are going to finish it. You are going to achieve all in the mighty name of Jesus. Let us therefore run the race that is set before us. Can we just turn to somebody, please, and tell the person, you know what? There is a race before you. Oh, remind your neighbor once again, say there is a race before you. And you got to run that race. Hallelujah. Every man is called into a Christian race. And how we run the race matters. We need to understand the ultimate, therefore, that God wants us to achieve as we run the race. Genesis chapter number 1, going back to the law of first mention. Genesis chapter 1, verse number 26, when God was to create man, God said, let us create man in our own image and likeness, that he may have dominion over all the creatures. Let us create man in our own image and likeness. That is to say, when I looked into my good intentions of creating man, I want him to be like me. That is all I see there. And I want him to function like me. That is all I see there. So listen to me, ladies and gentlemen. Your creation is not to be a mess on the earth. God has not sent you here to be part of the problems. He has sent you here to be the solution provider. Am I talking to somebody here? Now, you see, when God looked at darkness, God said, look, let this darkness turn to light. Am I right? He looked at voidity and converted it into beautiful and wonderful substance that we see today. Now, listen, ladies and gentlemen, that is what God is saying. He said, I want man to function like this. That means wherever you find yourself, God is saying, a solution enters there. You know, one of the reasons why you've been praying, Lord, change my place of work, and you've not seen anything. See, ladies and gentlemen, God is saying that you're yet to see what I'm saying. You're supposed to function like me. You don't need to call on me. Change the situation by yourself. I put the power in you. Am I talking to somebody here? I wanted to function like me. I wanted to speak the word of faith, and angels will confirm it. Am I talking to somebody here? God is saying, glory be to God. I have created it to be in my image and to function in my likeness. The problem is that many people are in the image of God, but they are not functioning like God. And in this series, somebody is going to rediscover himself. I mean, in this series, somebody is going to rediscover himself. You are coming back to function in the original purpose of God for your life. If there be any devil that in any way has been hindering any good thing from coming through for you, I curse that devil in the name of Jesus. I speak right now that all blockages are removed from your path now. Am I talking to somebody here? So God said, I want it to be in my image and I want it to function like me. Now listen, ladies and gentlemen, this is the law of first mention. It tells us the reason for your creation. Friend, the reason for your creation is to be like God. That is it. And that is the ultimate purpose of God for your life. There is no purpose higher than that. Many people will say, no, pastor, but you know, Christianity, our final home is heaven. That is your final home. The day you believe in Jesus, you are good to go, and you are good to be in heaven if you go. Am I talking to somebody here? The day you gave your life to Jesus, you're already a candidate of heaven. The day you gave your life to Jesus, the ticket, the license has been given to you. So listen, ladies and gentlemen, if you still live 30, 40, 50 years here after you've given your life, and you're telling me that heaven is the final, whatever. No, heaven is not the final. Heaven is just part of the show. The ultimate is conformity to his image. The ultimate is what? Conformity to his image. That is the central reason for your creation, ladies and gentlemen. That is the reason why God looked at you and created you. He wants you to look like him and to function like him. Ladies and gentlemen, to be seen battered Christianity is not a pleasure to God. And that's why I'm so glad to tell everybody here today. In this series, you will rediscover yourself. Everything that has been an harassment in your life, you will look for them and find them no more. And because your amen is louder, you are receiving a miracle immediately. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? The ultimate is conformity to his image. In Romans chapter number 8, starting from verse 28, The Bible says, and this we know, all things work together for good for those that love God, that are called according to his purpose. Verse 29. For those he did foreknow, he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, who is the firstborn among the brethren. For those he did foreknow, he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son. So listen, ladies and gentlemen, God is saying my central purpose for your creation is conformity to the image of Jesus. And when I'm conformed to the image of Jesus, ladies and gentlemen, it takes me back into Genesis 1:26. Conformity to the image of Jesus takes me back into the realities of Genesis 1:26. Because Jesus, the Bible said in Hebrews chapter number 1, talking about Jesus, Hebrews chapter number 1 and verse 3, the scripture says who Jesus is, the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. So Jesus is the image of God. And when I conform now to that image, I am going back into conformity with the image of God. Genesis 1:26. Let us make man in our own image. That is the ultimate of God for your life. That is the central purpose of God for your creation. Am I talking to somebody here? That your life may look like him. That everything that obtains in heaven is what obtains in your life here. Glory be to God. I'm glad to tell somebody here, you are starting heaven on earth. From now, you are starting heaven on earth. Amen. I mean, from now, you are starting heaven on earth. Amen. Because you are the one I'm talking about. Hit somebody high five. And tell the person, I'm starting heaven on earth. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? God wants you and I to function in this world as Jesus has functioned. That is the reason why he sent Jesus into the world for us. And that is his central purpose for your life. The Bible says, and all things work together for good for those that love God, that are called according to his purpose. What is that purpose? He said, for those he did foreknow, he did predestinate, that they be conformed to the image of his son. So please understand, the central purpose of God for your creation is conformity to his image and likeness. That is the ultimate of your Christian race. As you keep coming to church, listening to the word, hearing the word, you see, aspects of your life are getting changed every day. You are seeing your life conforming into the image of Jesus. You are seeing Christ's likeness in your life. You are seeing that hunger dropping off and you are taking off patience instead. You are seeing that attitude of greed dropping off and you are taking off love instead. Am I talking to somebody here? You are seeing several aspects of your life changing and being transformed. Listen, it is centrally going towards what we see in Jesus. Am I talking to somebody here? And I'm glad to let you know, you will hit the ultimate. Amen. Oh, somebody's not catching what I'm talking about. I say you will hit the ultimate. Amen. Turn to somebody, say, I'm hitting the ultimate. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? That is the central reason why God has created you and I. That we be conformed into his image. In Ephesians chapter number 4. Ephesians chapter number 4. Starting from verse number here, the Bible says, when Jesus ascended on high, he left captivity captive and he gave gifts unto men. What are the gifts? Verse number 11. He gave unto some apostles and prophets and evangelists, pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints for the work of the ministry unto the edification of the body of Christ. Until we all grow up and come in the unity of faith and of love unto a perfect man. Attaining the full measure of perfection found in Christ. That is NIV. Now, King James says, growing up to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. You know what God is talking about? The reason why God has given you pastors, the reason why God has given you teachers, the reason why there are evangelists walking around your life, the reason why God has decorated your life with prophets, giving you apostles, the totality of the perfection which they are to attain in the life of the saint. You know, he said he has given all this for the perfecting of the saints. Now, the perfection which they are to attain in the life of the saint is to bring them up to the measure of the full of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That means bring them up to the measure of the perfection that is found in Jesus. You know what God is talking about? Jesus is my complete comprehensive syllabus for your life. He has everything you ever need. Jesus had come to demonstrate it. So listen, ladies and gentlemen, I don't need to be looking for how to please God. All I need to know, all I need to do is to look into the functional details of the life of Jesus and then reproduce the things that he did in my own life. The moment I can do that, I'm so sure I'm living a life where pleasing honor God. Am I talking to somebody here? I'm living a life where what? Pleasing unto God. This is all it takes to fulfill the ultimate in Christianity. This is all it takes to conform to his image. Looking at Jesus and reproducing those things that you see in his life, in your own life. That is all. See, this is Christianity made easy. Am I right? The Bible talks about the simplicity that is in Christ. Come on, tell somebody Christianity is easy. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? Christianity is what? It's easy. And that's the reason why I said, come unto me, O ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you what? I will give you rest. So if there's anybody here that you are going through any tension, in the name of Jesus, I bring big relief unto you. Amen. I mean, I bring big relief unto you. Amen. I bring big relief unto you. Amen. By the power of the Holy Ghost, every tension is taken off your lives. Amen. It is easy. Tell somebody it is easy. That is it. We find it easy in him. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love Jesus. Glory be to God. He's the ultimate of God for our lives. That is all God has called you and I to attain. Do you understand what I'm talking about? That is the reason why he has called us. When you gave your life to Jesus, he gave you a mandate. He gave you an assignment. Conform to his image. Every day you go to church, you hear my word. Every day you open your Bible, every day you pray, something is being deposited in your life, bringing about a transformation on a daily basis into that perfect image. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, Jesus wouldn't come if that image is not perfect. I mean, if what he sees in the body is not what he is. Am I talking to somebody here? The Bible says in Ephesians chapter number 5, starting from verse number 1. Verse 25. Ephesians 5 from verse 25. Husband, love your wives as Christ has loved the church, that he may wash it with the washing of water by the word. That is what is happening right now. The word of God is washing somebody here, that he may present unto himself a glorious church, not without wrinkles nor blemish, but must be holy. And must be without what? It must be spotless. Everything must be perfect about the church. So the church that Jesus is coming back for is a perfect church. Do you understand? And that's the reason why God is releasing this kind of message, because Jesus will firstly come in us before he comes for us, and then he will come with us. Those are the three layers of his coming. Am I talking to somebody here? He will firstly come in you. He will firstly walk in you, that people will see you and they will say, see, I can see Jesus in your life. Am I talking to somebody here? If there be anybody here, you are under any bondage in your life. And I mean the bondage of sin. That same nature won't just allow the best of Christianity to show up in your life. Oh, come on, I feel an anointing here. That yoke is being broken right now. I mean, that person is being liberated right now. By the power of the Holy Ghost, God is taking you to a higher level. By the anointing of God, God is taking you to a higher level. Come on, tell somebody, I'm going higher. I'm moving up in the name of Jesus. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? That is the ultimate for your life. God wants you to reproduce himself. He wants you to see yourself and be happy. That yes, I look like Jesus. Glory be to God. You know, the Bible says in Acts chapter number 11, that from verse 25, Barnabas went to Tarsus and he picked Brother Paul. Acts 11 from verse 25. He picked Brother Paul. And then he was called Saul there. So he picked him and they went to Antioch. And they began to gather together. They began to assemble with the church. And they began to teach them, raising disciples for God. And the Bible says they taught many there. For a year they were there just teaching and teaching. Now listen, ladies and gentlemen, the scripture says, and there the disciples were first called Christians. Why? They looked at them and they said, these people are like Jesus, exactly like Jesus. Everything we could see about them is like Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, they could see in their lives the power of God, and they could see in their lives the nature of God. Jesus represents the two aspects of God for us on the earth. He represented the power of God and he represented the nature of God. He represented the power of God and the nature of God. Many believers only want the power of God. Oh yes, we just want power to flow. The moment you are anointed, that is when people believe that you are like, no, it is not only the anointing that makes you conform to his image. You need the character line of God as well. Am I talking to somebody here? You can't be very abusive. You can't be living a life that is loose. You talk loose. You live loose. You fight. Everybody look at you. There is nothing that is Christianly in your life. And then you carry your Bible and say, look, I'm married to Jesus. You're not married to him. You understand what I'm talking about? There are some Christians that their Christianity is a disgrace. I was talking to a lady one day. I said, you know, if you marry a God-fearing born-again Christian, the lady said, you are right. He said that first phrase you made mention of is actually the right thing there. He said, God-fearing, because there are many born-again Christians that are not God. So there are not God-fearing born-again Christians and God-fearing. Am I talking to somebody here? If they said there is an embezzlement and there is a sharing of money, don't be surprised that you will find them there. Oh, yes. Let them look into a batch of money that was returned to Nigeria. You will trace it to some Christians, not even Christians, Jim Christians, that also collected their own national, part of the national cake, doing spiritual cleansing. Are you catching what I'm trying to say? There are some certain things, ladies and gentlemen. It's sad. Neil shouldn't carry these things. That this amount of money so was given to Christians. You know, during the campaign, Pastor Adeboye said those pastors that collected money should go and return it. They collected. You don't understand? They gathered together and I said, look, we are giving our whatever. I said, how dead are they in the spirit? That you cannot pick that God is saying this man is off his plans. And you are the headship of Christianity in terms of Jinjin in Nigeria. Are you catching what I'm trying to say? See, ladies and gentlemen, you know what God is saying? We need to get, of course, when you have collected money, it will corrupt your sensitivity. Your antenna just goes down straight. You don't know what God is saying. You will be coming together to be deciding against God's purpose. I'm telling you, Buhari, for now, is God's purpose for Nigeria. It's a shame that there was not a single Christian who had been there, and we've been having Christians, that had the God to fight corruption the way their mind is fighting. I mean, it's a big shame. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a call to each and every one of us. We are all in church praying that God should lift us. But God is looking at your life. Can I find a character trait that can bring about my purpose if I lift you there? Am I talking to somebody here? It's not just about prayers, ladies and gentlemen. It's about conformity. Come on, tell somebody it's about conformity. Is somebody catching what God is talking about this morning? The Lord said there is somebody here, like a brony kidehandala hak do zunamante. There is a lie that is hovering around you. That is said, I'm clearing off that lie right now. Thank you, Holy Spirit of God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You are here, you are feeling some inconvenience in your body. The healing power of God is taking it out right now. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? You see, ladies and gentlemen, we need to get to the point where we understand that the ultimate of Christianity. Before Buhari came, we've had Christians there at least consistently for 16 years. No, 8 plus 5, 13 years. 13 years. And Buhari had not spent 1 year. You know how this man has exposed corruption like anything in this nation? Only even to hear that it was even the Christian government itself that were corrupt. They put one whatever on WhatsApp where they showed one ex-president who carried one guitar and was saying he wants to share testimony that he's grateful to God that, what's the name of that man? Mentioning their names. The NSA. He said it is grateful to God that Asuki, another week he has not mentioned his name. He's grateful to God. Another week has passed. That's not what? Mention his name. But we give God the praise. We give God the praise. Friends, if a Muslim could do it, a Christian can do better. Am I talking to somebody here? A Christian can what? Should do better. Because we are exactly like God. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. Come on, turn to your neighbor. Say, I know myself. I'm exactly like God. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter number 4 that we read, he said the ultimate of God is taking us into this height where we exactly reproduce Jesus. A man who knew no sin. Man, he was a perfect man when he was on the earth. And God is saying, this is the perfection I want to see in you. The Bible says, he that knew no sin became sin unto us. That means not a single corruption could be found in his pocket. He had Jesus been the president of Nigeria, every kobo could have been spent on Nigeria. That is what God is saying. A man who knew no sin. Friend, God is moving Christianity to a higher height. I'm telling you, and you are the, you know what God is telling me? He's reproducing or he's producing leaders from this meeting. I'm telling you, God is packaging people that he will set in places from this meeting. In this month where God is producing leaders, you are one of the ones God is producing. Is somebody catching what God is talking about? This is the ultimate of Christianity, conformity to the image of his son. In Acts chapter number 4, the Bible made us to understand something very strategic here. Acts chapter number 4, Peter raised the lame man in the preceding chapter and all that, you know, and they brought him before the Sanhedrin, Peter and John and all that. And then Peter began to speak. And after he finished speaking in verse 12, the Bible says in verse 13. The Sanhedrin, they looked at him. The Bible says, and they perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men. And they marveled at their boldness. He said, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and knowing that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled. But they took knowledge that they had been with what? With Jesus. You know what they could see? They could see Jesus in his words. They could see the bold. You know, in the days of Jesus, Jesus was very bold. When they told soldiers to go and arrest him, soldiers came back. They said, never did man speak like him. He was terrifically bold. He said, woe unto you, Pharisees. Ah! He would look at the Pharisees in church, inside service, in their own. You know, the Pharisees were the leaders of the temple. And he would look at them and would say, you hypocrites. Which one of you on Sunday will any of your hearts fall into the ditch and you won't bring it up? And you are telling me not to heal on Sundays? And you are looking at the bishop of the temple and you say, you hypocrite. That's Jesus. That is who? Jesus. Very terrifically bold. The Bible said, when they saw this boldness, they knew that this must have been with Jesus. Ladies and gentlemen, that is what God wants us, wants to reproduce in our lives. When people see you, they can see Christ's likeness. When they see you in business, they can see Christ's likeness. See, coming to church is not all about, Pastor, I want my breakthrough. I want my wife. I want my husband. Pastor, I need my next level promotion. No, God is saying that hunger must leave your life. God is saying, look, that thing that you are doing must be changed after the order of his will. And at the same time, God is saying that your situation, even practically as well, must also change. Friends, it's all about conformity. And I see men and women walking in their ultimate purpose. Somebody's getting more conformed. Glory be to God in the highest. Ephesians chapter number 5, therefore, verse number 30, the scripture says something very fascinating here that blessed me so much anytime I meditate on it, and it's one of the key scriptures I use in the power ministry. Ephesians chapter 5 and verse number 30, the Bible says, we are members of his body, of his flesh and of his bones. So listen, ladies and gentlemen, God is saying you are already part and parcel of me. I want to live my life in you. My leg cannot tell my brain that, or my head that, hey, come. You head turned upside down and you start walking. No, it is my brain that gives instructions to my leg. Jesus is the head of the body. That's what the scripture says. Instruction comes from him. Do you understand what I'm talking about? And my leg therefore takes my body into where my brain instructs. That's what Jesus is saying. I want to live through you. I want to live the kind of life I lived on the earth through you. And friends, whether the devil likes it or not, when people see you, they will see Jesus. Amen. When people see you after now in your health, they will see Jesus. Amen. To be sick does not reflect Christ, because there was never a day that he was sick. So I'm telling somebody here, that body will conform to Jesus. Amen. Jesus was not barren. Listen to me, ladies and gentlemen. He wasn't barren. He was a fruitful one. He finished, and of course, he raised disciples for God. Do you understand what I'm talking about? So you cannot be here and not reproduce. If there be anybody here under the curse of barrenness, I'm glad to let you know it is lifted today. I mean, your body must conform to the image of Jesus. Am I talking to somebody here? My Jesus lived in prosperity. The Bible says that you may know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, he was what? He became poor. When did he become poor? When he was crucified nakedly. That was the time they parted his garment. And nakedness is the highest level of poverty. Do you understand me? But before that time, Jesus maximized his chances in financial prosperity. So I'm glad to tell somebody here, you will never live in the reverse. Am I talking to somebody here? That is what God is talking about. I want every aspect of your life to reflect him. So in this series, ladies and gentlemen, we will begin to look at different aspects of Jesus' lives and how we can emulate and imitate those things which we see in his life. We will look into his social life. We'll look into his spiritual life. We'll look into, you know, his financial life, you know, his relationships and, you know, his educational life and all that. We're going to look into different aspects of Jesus' life. And we're looking into how those things directly relate with us. There is somebody here. The Lord said, I should tell you. He said that chest area, stroke your arm area, is being released right now. He said, check it. You have a testimony there already. Glory be to God in the highest. Father, we give you all the praise. Am I talking to somebody here? We're going to look into different aspects of Jesus' lives. I'm going to see how those aspects directly relate with us. So I start today with his spiritual life. I start with his spiritual life. Let's look at the spiritual life of Jesus. And let's look at the things that we can learn, that we can, you know, take into our lives. Now listen, ladies and gentlemen, we cannot finish exploring Jesus. It will take eternity to explore Christ. He is the wonder of eternity. But at least we can learn something. Am I right? And it can make our Christian work better. Amen. Glory be to God. Come on, tell somebody I'm moving forward. Say it again, I'm moving forward. In my Christian work, I'm moving forward. Hallelujah. Is somebody understanding what God is saying this morning? Okay. Let's look at his spiritual life. And today, there are different aspects of his spiritual life. I would like to start with his prayer life. Glory be to God. His prayer life. That is the life, as far as prayer is concerned, that God wants you to conform to. Now, let me tell you this. The Bible says, until we all grow up to a perfect man, attaining the full measure of perfection that is found in Christ. That is to say, Jesus has modeled everything that God wants from us, unto us. He is the pattern son and the pattern disciple. He is the pattern that God wants your life to follow. He is the pattern that God wants your life to be structured after. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, he is the exact pattern for your life. Come on, tell somebody, he's the pattern for my life. He's my role model. Is somebody catching what I'm talking about? Jesus is our role model and is our general. Glory be to God. So my life is to be reproduced after his own life. Once I can just meet up with his standard, then I meet up with a satisfactory standard with God. That is all God expects from me. He's the pattern. Glory be to God. His prayer life. Jesus had an amazing prayer life, and it's so amazing that, ladies and gentlemen, his humanity reflected in his prayer life. Now, let me tell you this, ladies and gentlemen. Every time you think about Jesus, what comes to your mind is he was God when he was on earth. No, that is a big lie. When Jesus came to the heart, he came as man. Do you understand what I'm talking about? So everything you will see in the four gospels is the humanity of Jesus. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Now, with divinity on it. I mean, in terms of the Holy Ghost empowerment resting on it. He came as man, and he functioned here as man. The Bible says in Philippians chapter number 2, starting from verse 6. In fact, I love how the scripture says he did not count it to be robbery to be equal with God and all that, but he humbled himself. And now verse 7, I love New Living Translation, how he puts it. He said he deprived himself of every divine privilege when he was coming, and took upon himself the form of a servant. So every deity was off his life when he came here. He removed his deity and dropped it in heaven when Jesus came here. So he came as you and I came. Glory be to God. Am I talking to somebody here? He came the way you came and he came the way I came. So what made a difference about the life of Jesus was the empowerment of the Holy Ghost. No wonder when he went back to his hometown. Oh, the Lord said, I should tell somebody here. You are returning this week a wonder to your world. I said, you are returning this week a wonder to your world. When he went back to his hometown, they said, is this not Jesus, the son of Mary? His brother's not with us and his sisters. From whence get this man these things that he's talking about? What wisdom is this? That some such mighty works are wrought by him? Do you understand what I'm talking about? Because he grew up for 30 years in that community, they didn't see anything divine about him. He was as normal as anybody. In fact, is this not the carpenter? According to Mark. Are you catching what I'm talking about? He was as normal as any other person, ladies and gentlemen. Am I talking to somebody here? But something made a difference about his life. It's the incoming of the Holy Ghost. Glory be to God. The moment the Holy Ghost came on him, something different started in his life. Friends, you are here. You have the Holy Ghost. Gagabo shananata gabradia. There is a difference about your life. You can't return the same way you've been. I'm telling you, from today, the glory of the Spirit is oozing out of your life. I mean, the beauty of God is coming out of your life. Is somebody catching what I'm talking about? When the Holy Ghost comes upon your life, it comes with a difference. Come on, tell somebody, it comes with a difference. He's a difference maker. And he's the change producer. When it comes on the life of a man, come on, ladies and gentlemen, everything changes. So if you have the Holy Ghost, things can remain the same for you. Glory be to God. So here it is, ladies and gentlemen, Jesus received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He had left everything called deity in heaven. He was a man here. And all through his prayers, you will see his humanity reflecting. The Bible said in Hebrews chapter number 5 and verse number 7. Hebrews chapter 5 verse 7. The scripture says, Jesus, who in the days of his flesh, offered up prayers and supplications unto God, unto him that is able to deliver him from death. He offered up prayers and supplications with tears and strong crying. Unto him that is able to deliver him from death. And he was heard in that he feared. He offered up prayers and supplications unto God, unto him that is able to deliver him from death with tears and strong crying. That is to say, he was a man. The same way I would have prayed, Lord, channel me, this one, that one, with tears. Jesus also prayed that same way. Ladies and gentlemen, he functioned as a man. He didn't function as a God. Am I talking to somebody here? But as empowered by the Holy Ghost. Glory be to God. That is to say, there is hope for me because now I can see somebody who came in my likeness and attained this level. If he can, then I can. Oh, come on. I don't know who I'm talking to here. Is somebody catching what I'm talking about? If Jesus can, then you can. Talk to yourself. Say, if Jesus can, then I can. Is somebody catching what I'm talking about? If Jesus can enter that realm, then ladies and gentlemen, you and I can function at that realm. And I'm glad to let you know, if you can live a life debt-free, somebody here is debt-free. If you can live a life sickness-free, somebody here is sickness-free. If Jesus can live a life sin-free, somebody here is sin-free. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, if he can, I can. Glory be to God. So, friends, we begin to look at his prayer life and we begin to look at some certain things that are great blessings unto us in his prayer life. He prayed as a man. He cried in prayers. He shed tears in prayers, just as a man would have done. Angels won't pray and they are shedding tears, but Jesus will. Spirits won't pray and they are shedding tears, but he will. He wrote his emotions into prayers. Glory be to God. He feared in place of prayer. He looked at death and he didn't want to go and die. That means he was a man, who? He was what? He was a man. Glory be to God. And thank God because he modeled it as a man. He didn't model it as a spirit. If he has modeled it as a spirit, I could have seen that level very, very unattainable. But he has modeled it as a man. What are the things we see in his prayer life? Number one, there are several things we begin to see in his prayer life. We just pick them zigzag. Am I talking to somebody here? But you see, adding those things to our prayer life, you know, it challenges us up and it helps us to be balanced in Christianity. Amen. Number one, we could see that the prayer life of Jesus provoked the supernatural. He provoked what? The supernatural. Now listen, ladies and gentlemen, the first thing I wanted to see here is that the prayer life of Jesus is properly positioned. Jesus, instead of asking for bread, is asking God for the power to provide bread. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Instead of saying, give me this substance, Jesus is saying, Father, put me in command of the substance. His prayer life provoked the supernatural. The Bible says in Luke chapter, let's look at John chapter 6. You know, there were people with him, and then of course they were hungry. And Jesus, you know, the next thing he did, he just took the bread, he gave thanks, and he distributed it. In another place, he was talking to his disciples, and those disciples forgot to carry bread. And they felt, when he was talking about the living of the Pharisees and all that, they thought Jesus was talking about bread. And Jesus said, were you not there when I multiply? If it is the issue of bread, whether you are here with bread or not, I can always multiply bread here. Do you understand what I'm talking about? So, you see, you know what he's talking about? Instead of saying, Lord, keep providing bread, give me the power to multiply bread. Put me in command. Give me the power to command bread to be. Apostle Babalala went to the mountaintop 40 days and the people forgot to bring bread. And they were fasting. So they were hungry. And they discovered that they only had one loaf of bread. Baba said, go and hang it there. They hung it. He said, yeah, every one of you, go and be cutting your home portion there. The first person went, cut his own. The bread grew back instantly. The first second person went, cut. The bread grew back. The third person went, ladies and gentlemen, until they were all fed and satisfied. The bread kept growing back. That is power. That is what? So, you see, God is talking about, and there are different fields of power. There is financial power. Instead of saying, God, give me a job, God, give me a producer of job. Make me, am I talking to somebody here? Instead of saying, God, make me an employee. No, Father, make me an employer of labor. A lot of you have been asking for things that are underneath, and Jesus went high. Somebody's stepping up. I said, somebody's stepping up. Is somebody catching what God is talking about today? Another thing we see here in the provocation of the supernatural is that his prayers provoked the supernatural in his ministries. The Bible said Jesus, after 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness, fasting and all that, he came down, Luke chapter number 4, verse 14, in the power of the Spirit. In the what? He was in the wilderness communing with God, communicating with the Almighty for 40 days. When he came out, the Bible said he came down in the power of the Spirit, and from that day the supernatural started. Ladies and gentlemen, blind eyes started opening, deaf ears started hearing. I mean, a lot of things started happening. Friends, in your life, things should happen in the supernatural. Do you know that if we Christians are to be very sincere, I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, a lot of Christians, if they do a proper assessment of their life, there's nothing supernatural about them. Ask yourself, when last, okay, ask your neighbor, because if you ask yourself, turn to your neighbor. And the neighbor must answer. I said, neighbor, you must answer. When last did you witness the supernatural in your life? Oh yeah, answer. You know, in the presence of God, you cannot lie. Do you understand what I'm talking about? The supernatural is supposed to be our daily life. Friends, I see God naturalizing the supernatural for you. Yeah. It's supposed to be the realm where you function on a daily basis. It's not a realm where you struggle to enter. No, that's supposed to be your city of domicile. Am I talking to somebody here? You see, in my life, if a miracle does not happen a day, I always naturally think God has forsaken me. I see miracles every blessed day. Somebody will come in with a testimony. You gave me this word, it happened. Hey, you did it. I said, something must happen. The supernatural must be the reoccurring thing in your life. Why should you be living a natural life and you are subjected to the natural menace that others are subjected to? No, no. Jesus entered the supernatural realm through prayers. So, ladies and gentlemen, tarry in prayers to enter the supernatural. Because in the moment you can pray, the supernatural follows. The supernatural does what? He follows. The problem is that many believers don't pray. And when we pray, we want to just spend 5 minutes and we're out of it. No, Jesus tarried. Do you know the meaning of 40 days? Day and night? Friend, there is nothing longer than tarrying there. He tarried. He did what? He spent time communicating with God. You can't spend time with God and the affairs of life not listen to you. The supernatural will naturally follow. The Bible made us to understand in Acts chapter number 4 when the apostles prayed. They gathered together. Acts chapter number 4 from verse 23. And being let go, they went back to their home company. The Bible says, and they reported all that the chief priests and the elders said unto them. And having heard this, they lifted up their voice and began to pray. And then they ended the prayer in verse 30. Verse 31, the Bible says, and where they prayed shook when they prayed. Glory be to God. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Can you see? That's the first sign. That see the supernatural happening after they finished praying. Where they prayed shook, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, and they went forth and preached the word with boldness, fearlessly. That's the second sign. The third one, verse 33, the Bible said, and with great power they bore witness to the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, and great grace was upon them all. Can you see? Verse 34, and none of them lacked. Can you see? Every lack was taken out of their life. For those who had properties went to sell it and brought all the money and all that. I mean, abundance was created around them. Remember, this whole story started from Acts chapter 3, when they raised the man at the beautiful gate. And dear Peter declared lack. He said, oh, brother John, please, if there is anything we can give this man. They searched, they didn't get. He said, silver and gold I don't have. But when they prayed, they had. When they prayed, they did what? They had. Do you understand what I'm talking about? See the supernatural just. And then, you know, the story continues with that verse designation. Do you understand? Before these English people just said, let's stop here and say chapter 5, start from here. No, it just continued a whole story like that. So he entered into chapter 5 straight. Verse 1, the story of Ananias and Sapphira, the man and the woman who came to corrupt the system. God was moving after prayers, and somebody said he wants to corrupt it. God cleared them off. That is divine clearance on anybody that wants to stay on your way. Yeah. If somebody catch what I'm talking about. So if you are experiencing blockages or contamination of flows, I'm glad to let you know if you pray.
We believe you have been blessed by this message. For more information, prayers, and counseling, you can reach us on the following numbers: 080-33-706-938 and 080-28-281839, or visit our website at www.dgccinternational.org and connect with us on our social media platforms: facebook.com/DGCCINTL, Instagram at DGCCINTL. On YouTube, search Divine Glory Christian Church. Our Twitter handle is @DGCCINTL. Stay blessed.